Okay. Okay, there are next, before I start the class, there are also some questions that a few of you have already asked. So this is the first question. Why haven't you uploaded all lecture notes? Some other lecturers already provide complete lecture notes, so I can have overview about what I will learn. Okay, so the answer is because my lecture notes has been used for quite a number of years, so I need to update them. If you remember, there was one student who asked last week, why was the code of the subject for the tutorial is different from the present code? So it's because I haven't updated the notes. So I think it's timely for this semester for me to update the content, and that's why it's taking a bit longer for me to complete the whole the lecture note for the whole subject, because I'm looking back into what needs to be updated. Okay, so I can't guarantee which week will complete everything, but should be within the next 2 weeks time. It should be completed up until sensors and transducers. And then another question, you said there will be video available in your YouTube channel. When will it be available? Okay, so I haven't got into editing the videos yet. This early semester has been quite busy for me. So for now, you can access the videos by checking the conversation thread in Microsoft Teams. Let's hope I have some free time so I can edit the videos and upload it soon. Okay, so thank you for the questions. Now, if there are any more questions, please let me know. Any concerns with your learning process and progress, also you can communicate with me. Okay, so can I start now the lecture?
Yes, sir.
Okay. I forgot one thing. I forgot to register the attendance. So never mind, I'll start the lecture first, and then later on I'll open the attendance in ULearn. Okay, so thank you for your response, Fauzan, and one other guy, I don't know, I just heard his voice. Okay, can you see the presentation?
Yes, sir.
Yes, doctor.
Okay, good. But I can't see my own presentation. Hold on, yeah. Okay, hold on, please. Okay, now I can see. Okay, so today I'm going to start with the topic on DC meter. So just in case you haven't uploaded downloaded week 4. So tomorrow the quiz will also be accessible at the same section, which is in week 4. So let's move on. What are we going to learn today? So the learning outcome for today is number one is to sketch the construction, to be able to sketch the construction of permanent magnet moving coil or the Arsonval instrument, which is the basic instrument for DC measurement. Okay, now we are still in the process of studying on the DC meters. Okay, so the basic meters, analog meters, and then design DC ammeter and DC voltmeter using there are some students who cannot enter the meeting. Hold on. Okay, ada tiga orang request dalam nak masuk group meeting ni, so saya dah approve. Daniel T, Faris dengan Hairul Atika. Okay, so Faris ada message ni, saya dah approve lah. Alright. So saya memang tak buka WhatsApp masa tengah lecture, so you can remind me at the meeting chat. Okay, now after that, design DC ammeter and DC voltmeter, and then number three, design multi-range DC ammeter and DC voltmeter using Ayrton shunt. And then define loading ammeter insertion effect, and finally design ohmmeter using the Arsonval instrument. So let's see how far I can cover for today. Okay, the Arsonval movement. Okay, this is a bit theory. So you see the figure on the right hand side here. So you see the bar here, and you see the wire here. The wire is wrapped around the bar, and the bar is a magnetic coil. And we also have magnets at the left and right hand side of the bar. So the moving bar is connected to a scale or to a needle that will deflect depending on the interaction between the magnetic bar. So we already know that the polarity, right? North and north, they will repel each other. South and south also repel. North and south is going to attract each other. So what will happen in this figure, you will see that the permanent magnet, it will move from the left to right depending on its interaction with the permanent magnet on the left and right hand side. So the north and north will push the needle, and the north and south will attract the needle. So you'll see the movement, and the movement will be based on the current that is produced in the wire that is wrapped around the magnet bar at the middle there. Okay, so this is the most basic principle of a motor. Kalau you study motor, motor is basically when you want to turn the motor consists of the moving part and the static part. And how it is turned, the speed of the motor will depend on the magnetic flux and the strength of the magnetic field interaction. Okay, so if you are not familiar with the concept, never mind. Just go through a bit on the theory. Later on, I'll share with you a video on how a motor works, the basic principles of a motor from YouTube. Okay. This basic movement, so the middle will move based on the amount of current flowing in the circuit and the strength of the magnetic field. And this principle is called the D'Arsonval principle. And the design here is called a D'Arsonval galvanometer. So galvanometer is a term for a device that is very sensitive in detecting small amounts of current. Alright. So the coil here at the center, it is spring loaded. That means it is attached to a spring. And that's why it can move from left to right. And it has a fixed range. So the amount of rotation is proportional to the amount of current flowing through the coil. So you have positive and negative here. This is the place where the current flows. The stronger the amount of current, then the stronger the interaction between the magnet, then the stronger or the larger the needle will move. So this needle, also called a pointer, will show the result based on a scale that has already been defined earlier. So the scale has already been defined based on the amount of current that can be detected by the circuit. So from there we can measure what is the current flowing. So it needs to be calibrated first, either in terms of current or voltage. Okay, this is the basic construction. Now this is the practical construction of a D'Arsonval meter. Okay, we call it as permanent magnet moving coil. Okay, so with permanent magnet is the part outside here that is shaped like a inverted U, like an N, like the letter N here. This one is the permanent magnet. So they call it as a horseshoe shape. Bahasa Melayu dia ladam kuda. So the at the sole of the horse, kan biasanya bentuk dia macam U ataupun macam N terbalik, macam N atau U terbalik. So they call it as horseshoe. So that is the term that is used here. The term that is used here, horseshoe. So why is it shaped like a horseshoe? Because it allows a larger magnet space for the coil to interact. Okay, so when there is a larger magnet coil, so that there is larger flux that is generated by the magnet. So the performance of the meter will be improved. Okay, so between the pole pieces is a cylinder of soft iron which serves to provide a uniform magnetic field in the air gap between the pole pieces and the cylindrical core. So this is the core here. Okay, and then we have a gap here. So the shaded area is the permanent magnet. And also the coil at the center is where the current flows. So you can see there is a small arrow here. So the current flows inside. And it will interact with the magnet to move the pointer or the needle. Okay. So the coil is wound on a light metal frame. Okay, so the circle here, the cylinder here is very light. And that it allows the pointer to be rotating freely. The coil to rotate freely within the space that is given here. And it will respond, the magnitude of the current will be corresponding to the value that is shown at the pointer. Okay. Now, this is a DC ammeter basic design. Okay, so the previous meter is the symbol is equivalent to this symbol here. Okay, the D'Arsonval meter or the D'Arsonval movement is the sign or the symbol given here, where the arrow, don't be confused, the arrow is not the direction of the current, but it's the needle pointing to the reading. So when you see this circuit, there are a few terms that you need to be aware of. So we have I is the total current flowing in the circuit coming from the source here. So the source, we have positive and negative. And then I is the total current. Once it reaches this point, the current will be divided into two, which is I shunt and IM. So IM stands for I meter. Okay, and then we have a resistor that is parallel to the meter. We call it as R shunt or shunt resistance. Okay, and the meter itself, because it is consists of a conductor, it also has its internal resistance. It's quite small, but it's there. So we label it as RM, which refers to the meter resistance. Okay. So ada student yang komen privately, dia kata saya cakap laju. Memang betul, saya memang cakap laju. Saya try slow lah sikit, tapi kalau terlalu laju, you have to remind me lah. Kawan-kawan saya pun cakap saya cakap laju. Tapi saya rasa biasa je. Okay, but hopefully that's not deter your learning experience lah. Okay, coming back. So coil winding is small and light, so it can only carry very small amounts of current. Okay, in the range of microamps or milliamps. So if we want to measure larger current, we need to add a shunt resistance. So R shunt. And we can determine using basic circuit analysis. So since many of you are from manufacturing, I think you have studied a bit on principle of electrics and electronics, but nevertheless, I will still go into the basics once again, just to make sure you fully understand what I'll be talking about. Okay, so these are the derivation. So let me explain what the derivation means. So we have the circuit is repeated again. So this is the current that is flowing in the meter, and this is the current that is flowing parallel to the meter. Now the current in the meter, the current that the meter can carry is very small. Maybe in the range of, let's say, 50 microamps, 100 microamps, and so on. If we want to measure a current that is larger than the current capacity of the meter, then we need to put a resistance parallel to the meter. And the resistance must be smaller than the resistance from the meter so that more current will flow here and less current will flow here. Okay, to illustrate what I mean, I have prepared an example after this, but let's see the derivation first. So according to basic circuit principles, if we have two components in parallel, selari, selari means it shares the same starting point and end point. Okay, in this circuit, point A is shared by R shunt and R meter. We do not look at the distance. We do not say that this line is shorter than this line. This is just a connection point. So basically we say that the R shunt, the starting, is connected to point A, and the end point is connected also to the same point. This point is connected here, and this point is also connected here. So we say that these two elements are parallel to each other. Okay, so the principle of parallel is that the voltage across these two elements will be the same voltage. So the voltage here, positive and negative, is equal to the voltage here and equal to the voltage here. So we have voltage shunt is equal to the voltage across the meter. And then we apply Ohm's law, V equals to IR. So we replace V with IR. So we get I shunt, R shunt, is equal to I meter, R meter. Okay, next, we modify the equation to get the value of R shunt, which is I meter divided by I shunt. Okay, then we apply KCL. KCL is Kirchhoff current law at point A. So Kirchhoff current law states that the total amount of current going into a node is equal to the amount of current flowing out of the node. Okay, bahasa Melayu dia, jumlah arus yang masuk ke dalam satu-satu node adalah sama dengan jumlah arus yang keluar. That means there will be no current that is staying at the node or going back. No. Current go in equals to current comes out. So we say that the total current I is equal to I shunt plus IM. So I going in is equal to I shunt plus IM. And so we have I shunt is equal to I minus IM. So we subtract the total current I with the current at the meter, we get the total current flowing in the shunt resistor. So now we replace this I shunt equals to I minus IM in the original equation. So we get R shunt equals to the current in the meter multiplied by the resistance in the meter divided by the total current minus the current in the meter. Okay, so this is the first equation. Please memorize and know how to use it. Alternative to this equation, we can also do another type of modification to the equation because we know that the total current I can also be considered as n times larger than IM. So the total current I is going to be large. We can consider it as a multiple of the current flowing in the meter. So we can put the equation as I equals to n multiplied by IM. Okay, we replace I equals to n IM in the equation. So we can further simplify the equation. We see here IM minus IM. So we can factor it out. So we get IM n minus 1. And we can cancel the current at the meter from the top to the bottom to get the shunt value is equivalent to the resistance of the meter divided by n minus 1. Where n is the current divided by the ratio of the current, the total current, divided by the current that is flowing in the meter. So this is the derivation. Now, let's look at the example. So a DC ammeter, based on a D'Arsonval principle, can carry 1 milliamp and has an internal resistance of 100 ohms. So the ammeter to be used to measure the current in the range of 0 to 100 milliamps. So calculate the value of the shunt resistance required. So let's go to the whiteboard. Okay, so let me first write down the basic info. So the DC Arsonval, the DC meter can carry 1 milliamp. Okay, so IM is equal to 1 milliamp. And then the internal resistance RM is equal to 100 ohms. And it wants to measure from 0 to 100 milliamp. Oh, sorry, wrong screen. Okay, so the current in the meter, it can only carry 1 milliamp and the internal resistance is 100 ohms. We want to use the meter to measure current between 0 to 100 milliamps. So the question is, what is the value of the shunt resistance? Okay, so let me draw the circuit again. So we have R shunt and we have the meter, R meter. Okay, this one is connected, yeah. So this is I, the total current. This is Aishan. And this is IM. Okay, so IM is given as 1 milliamp. RM is given as 100 ohms. So, what was the derivation just now? So we have V shunt equals to Vm. So I shunt, R shunt equals to I meter multiplied by R meter. So R shunt is equal to I meter multiplied by R meter divided by I shunt. So I meter we already know, R meter we already know. Now we need to find I shunt. So I shunt is equal to the total current minus the total current in the meter. So the total current is the maximum range we want to measure, which is 100 milliamps. So we write the total current is 100 milliamps minus with the current in the meter, 1 milliamps. So we have 99 milliamps. So the R shunt is equal to the current in the meter. So the current in the meter is 1 milliamp multiplied by the resistance of the meter. The resistance is 100 ohms divided by the current in the shunt, which is 99 milliamps. So you can cancel the milliamps and you get the answer is 100 divided by 99. So the answer is what? That is my calculator.
1.0 ohm.
So 100 divided by 99, I get 1.010101. Okay. So 1.0101. So I'm just going to write the last two digits up until two decimal point, which is the same as the answer, 1.01 ohms. So this is the answer that we want. Now, what is the meaning of this answer? Apa maksud bagi jawapan ini? If you look at the circuit here, the current in the meter or the meter itself can only carry a current of 1 milliamp. If there is no shunt resistor and you connect the source to 100, you connect the meter to 100 milliamp, this meter will be damaged. Okay, that is why we put a shunt resistor. You see here, the resistor at the meter is 100 ohms. The resistor of the shunt is only 1.01 ohm. This one is 100, this one is only 1.01. So the reason is that when the resistance is lower, more current will flow at this line here compared to this line. So we want only 1 milliamp to flow in the meter. The rest, 99 milliamp, we want it to flow in the shunt resistance. So the value of the shunt resistance must be 1.01 ohms for it to carry 99 milliamps. And we can measure, even though the current here is 100 milliamp, we can still use the meter to measure based on the principle of proportionality. And we protect the equipment from getting damaged. So now whatever reading we get here is still going to be the correct reading based on the range that we desire without sacrificing or damaging the equipment. So ini prinsip dia. Kalau saya cakap dalam bahasa Melayu, maksud dia bila kita ada satu perintang secara selari di sini, kita membenarkan arus mengalir lebih banyak di sini dan kurang di sini supaya dapat melindungi meter ni. Dan pada masa yang sama, kita masih boleh ukur sehingga 100 mA. So, basically, the larger the range of the current that we want to measure, then the smaller the shunt resistor needs to be. Katakan sekarang kita nak measure up to 200 milliamps, then the shunt resistance will be lower than 1.01, maybe around 0.5 ohms. Only 1 milliamp still flows in the meter, the rest must flow through the shunt resistance. So ini adalah asas dalam litar elektrik, macam mana kita nak protect satu-satu equipment, kita nak benarkan arus mengalir tanpa merosakkan equipment tu, kita pasang satu perintang secara selari. Okay, so that's the essence of having a DC ammeter. However, having an ammeter with a single range has limited use. Nah, kalau kita ada satu range je, susahlah bila nak tukar range, then kita kena modify kita punya circuit. So we can extend the range of the DC ammeter by adding several shunt. Shunt ni sama istilah dia, some equivalent dengan parallel. Bila kita kata shunt, shunt dengan parallel tu maksud dia sama. Selected by a range switch. Okay, and then such a meter is called a multi-range ammeter. So we have a possible configuration as shown in this figure here. So, kalau tadi we have only one resistance, so we can measure only one range of current. Now we have multiple resistances, so we can set the value of each resistance based on the value of current we want to measure. So in this example of this figure, when the switch here can rotate between any of these four position. Let's say now the switch is connected to R2. So now R2 has a complete circuit. So we see positive going to R2 and then going back to negative, and it's also parallel to the meter. So in this figure, now R2 is parallel to the meter. R1, R3 and R4, because it's not connected, we call it as open circuit and it does not affect the current flow. Arus tak akan masuk dekat R1, R3 dengan R4 ni kalau dia tak ada full circuit connected back to the source. So now the complete circuit is only R2 and the meter. Alright, so now we change the value depending on the range of current we want to measure. In this case, we can set four different ranges. If we add more, then we can add more ranges. And then this switch here, we call it as a multi-position switch. Okay, it has low contact resistance. That means the resistance at the contact point is very low, so that maximum current can flow, and high current carrying capacity, so it can carry large amount of current. And then it has a characteristic called make before break. Okay, make before break ni maksudnya, before we make a contact, let's say we want to switch from R2 to R3, it needs to complete the circuit first before we connect to the point. Bila kita nak switch, katakan daripada R2 ke R1, R2 ke R3, R2 ke R4, semasa kita switch tu, there is one issue that needs to be taken care of. If we not careful, then the meter here will be damaged. So that's why we need to use make before break. Okay, what is the meaning and why we need to use it? Consider the figure here. So let's say you are switching between R2 and R3. semasa you nak switch tu, in between, dia belum sampai R3 tapi dia dah tinggalkan R2. At this point, there is no connection between any of the resistor, either R2 and R3. So current, maximum current will flow directly to the meter only. In this condition, the meter will be, because it cannot carry more than the defined current that can be carried by the meter. So if we use ordinary switch, then the meter, this ammeter will be damaged already. So that's why when we want to switch, there is a component inside the make before break switch that will connect. Let's say you want to switch from R2 to R3, there will already be a connection to R3 before you make the switch. So that there will always be a resistance paired to the meter. Most of the current will flow in the resistance, not into the meter. Okay, so that's why we use the make before break. Another thing is by separate resistance designed for each of the rail. So R1 is for connected to each at time. So we need to calculate each values individually. Okay, there's also another method to kind of multi-range ammeter, but the resistance, we don't put it in parallel, we put it in series, which we are going to cover after this. Suara tak jelas. Okay. So I'll repeat this slide again, yeah. Okay, thank you for your comment. I think then I need to check my internet. Okay, is it connected? My UTM shouldn't have a problem. Later on, I'll check my speed. Okay, so I'll talk a bit slowly. So tadi what I was talking about is that for this type of ammeter, we have four different resistors, and each resistors need to be calculated separately depending on the range we want to set. Okay. So the type of meters can be up to 50 amps. And then when using this type of meter or any type of ammeter to be, we need to start by selecting the highest current range and then decrease the range until we find a good range to get the reading. Okay. And the resistance used for the various ranges are of very high precision value. Therefore, the cost of the meter increases. Okay, what is meant by this? Let's see the example in the next slide. Okay, so design a multi-range ammeter to provide an ammeter with a current range of 0 to 10 milliamps. Okay, that is range number 1. 0 to 20 milliamps, range number 2. And 0 to 50 milliamps, range number 3. So we are going to have three separate resistor connected in parallel through a multi-position switch. A DR Somval meter movement that has the meter resistance 100 ohms and full scale current 1 milliamp is used. So how do we solve? Dalam parallel diagram, current dalam diagram akan sama ke? Okay, hold on, let me go through this one first. So these are the answers for each of the shunt resistance. So for the range 0 to 10 milliamps, Okay, the top answer or the top part is always the same. It's going to be the current in the meter multiplied by the resistance of the meter. So 1 milliamp multiplied by 100 ohms is going to be the same for all three ranges. The only difference now is the value of I at the bottom. So I here is going to be 10 milliamps. This one is going to be 20 milliamps. And this one is going to be 50 milliamps. So this is the answer that we get. 11.11 ohm, 5.2 ohms, and 2.041 ohms. So if you see this value here, the value of the resistor needs to be very precise. Maknanya resistor yang you guna kena dapat value ni 11.11, 5.2, 2.041. Okay, so dekat pasaran, in the market, you cannot buy this type of resistor directly. You need to custom order for them to produce this type of resistance in this level of accuracy, 11.11. Biasanya kalau kita pergi kedai elektronik, kita beli perintang, dia akan ada standard range. Misalnya 1 kilo ohm, itu common. 100 ohm, common. 500 ohms. Kalau kita minta tiba-tiba 123 ohm misalnya, then dia akan suggest you combine lah, beli satu perintang 100 ohm, beli satu perintang 20 ohm, beli tiga perintang 1 ohm and then combine. Tapi bila you combine, error you akan bertambah lah. Kita dah belajar tentang summation error dengan limiting error. So bila you combine, error you akan bertambah. When you want to use this type of meter, the resistance needs to be precise. So you need to customize your resistance. That's why ayat dekat bawah ni tadi dia kata the value of the ranges has high precision value. Dia kena sangat tepat value dia. Therefore the cost of the meter increases. But you kena customize, then the cost of the meter will be higher. Okay, itu kelemahan lah, weakness of this type of meter. Okay, so coming back to the question, dalam parallel diagram, current dalam diagram akan sama ke tidak? Okay, kita consider contoh ni. So kita nak measure 10 milliamps, 20 milliamps dengan 50 milliamps. So let's say we refer to this figure here. Let's say we want to use R1, R2, R3. R1 to measure 10 milliamps, R2 to measure 20 milliamps, R3 to measure 50 milliamps. So the current that is flowing will depend on the range that we want to measure. So katakan kita nak measure range dia 50 milliamps. So what we need to do, first we need to position our switch to R3. So that if the current is 50 milliamps, then it will flow, most of the current will flow through R3 and a small amount of current will flow to the meter. So katakan sekarang kita nak measure 20 milliamps. So current flowing here is 20 milliamps, we can switch from R3 to R2. Kenapa kita nak switch? Supaya kita dapat bacaan yang lebih tepat. 50 milliamps boleh measure. Katakan 15 milliamps ataupun 10 milliamps. Kalau kita guna 50 milliamps, kita masih boleh measure tapi dia tak tepat lah. Okay, so to answer the question, current in the diagram will depend on the range of the current we want to measure. Okay, hopefully that answers the question. Okay. So design. Now let's try to do this. Design a multi-range ammeter with range of 0 to 1 amps, 0 to 5 amps, and 0 to 10 amps, employing individual shunt in each DR Sonval movement with an internal resistance of 500 ohms and a full-scale deflection of 10 milliamp is available. So these are the answers, 5.05, 1.002 and 0.005 ohms. So using the previous example, so please try and verify whether you get the same answer or not. Okay, so you modify a bit. Bagi soalan ini, the multi-range ammeter ada tiga range sahaja. So 0 to 1, 0 to 5, 0 to 10. So kalau you refer dekat figure ni, you tak pakai 4 lah. You akan pakai 3 resistance sahaja sebab dia ada 3 range sahaja. Okay, so this is just an example of the configuration. So nanti you kira lah R1, R2 dan R3. Dan proof you dapat result tu. Okay, same as the answer. Okay, so I have covered the basic of DC emitter and parallel multi-range DC emitter. Now, I want to go into a very important concept of the emitter, which is we call it as Ayrton shunt, or another name is universal shunt. Okay, I have some typo here. It's not Ayrton, it's Ayrton. A-Y-R. Okay, so now instead of you have parallel meters, parallel resistance, now you have resistance in series. Okay, the switch is still a multi-position switch. So I'm going to use three example of three resistance. So we have three ranges and we want to utilize this to measure multiple ranges of current. Okay, prinsip dia sama macam tadi. Kita nak ukur beberapa range untuk arus. Okay, but now the resistance are in series. And the combination here, RA plus RB plus RC, if it's connected to switch number 3, then it's going to be parallel to the meter. So kita kena tengok position kita punya switch ni dekat mana. So if it is position 1, you have this combination. If it is in position 2, you have this combination. And if it's in position 3, you have this combination. Sekarang cuba you bayangkan kalau dia berada pada switch 1, dia akan ada connection dengan RA ni. Jadi arus, current akan masuk di sini, positif, dia masuk di sini, dia akan lalu RA dan dia akan patah balik. Kemudian pada masa yang sama dekat point ini, dia akan parallel dengan circuit ini. Sekejap lagi, after this we look into a further explanation on the configuration. I'm just providing a simple explanation for now. So kalau katakan pada switch 2 ni, so you tengok kalau arus masuk dekat sini, positif, dia akan pergi sini, so dia akan pecah dua. Satu akan lalu sini, lalu RB, RA pergi ke negatif. Satu lagi dia akan lalu sini, RC, pass through ammeter, and then go back to negative. Kalau switch ni connect pada position 3, so we see the current will flow here. Kemudian dia pecah dua. Satu akan masuk sini, RC, RB, RA pergi balik negatif. Satu lagi akan lalu ammeter and then pergi balik negatif. Kalau switch tu dekat position 1 tadi, apa berlaku? Current akan masuk sini. And then dia akan pecah dua. Satu akan masuk RA dan pergi negatif. Satu akan masuk RB, RC, lalu dekat ammeter dan pergi balik negatif. So you kena bayangkan kalau dia connect pada position 1, position 2 dan position 3 akan jadi open circuit. There will be no current flowing back to this point. And the same goes for when we switch to position 2. And then position 1 and 3 will become open circuit. When we connect to position 3, position 2 and position 1 will become open circuit. So only one type of circuit will operate at any given time. Alright, now let's look at the derivation. So derive the equations to calculate the shunt resistance for the circuit below. Okay, saya terbalikkan je, saya twist saja dia punya circuit tu supaya lagi senang kita nak analyze. Okay, so you bayangkan, okay, we have three ranges, 10 milliamps, 100 milliamps and 1 amps. Okay, doesn't matter for the moment, we want to derive the equation. So the current will flow here. If we switch, let's say, to point 1 here, or point A here, then the current will flow here, pass through here, pass through here, and then go back to here, and then passing back through the negative. So you have positive and negative. This is the direction of the current. And then there will also be current passing through the meter. So we need to determine what is the value for all these resistances here. Okay, now we consider the first one. So to design the Ayrton shunt, you need to start with the smallest range or the most sensitive range. So in this example, the smallest range is 10 milliamps. So we are going to start with that value first. So we connect our switch to this point. So the current will flow in two circuits or in two parallel lines. So bila current flow here, and then it will be divided. One current will flow through RC, RB, RA, and then going back here to the negative. And then another portion of the current will go here, passing through the meter, and then going back to the negative. So we have one line indicated by the red circle and another line indicated by the blue circle. So the red circle here, the current that is flowing, we label it as the shunt current, I shunt. And the blue color here is the current passing through the meter, I meter. So look at the derivation carefully. R shunt equals to RC plus RB plus RA. Okay, this is the total shunt resistance with respect to the meter. So we apply the equation we learned for the basic DC ammeter, and we can get the total value of all this resistance. But we don't know what are the individual values yet. We just know what is the total resistance. Okay, so this is the first step. Okay, then. And this one is a bit complicated. So we turn now the switch from position A to position B. So what happens now? The current flowing is different. So in one direction, okay, this is the total current flowing. So after at this point, the current will be divided. One portion of the current will flow to RC, RB, and then going back to the negative. The other portion of the current will go through the ammeter and then go through RA and then flowing back to the selector to the negative. Okay, so you nampak ini adalah dia punya laluan arus. So one line here, the shunt resistance now when we switch to position B is no longer the total resistance, is going to be only RB plus RC. Okay, and the other will be ammeter plus RA. So we have the equation RC plus RB will be equal to ammeter plus RA. Okay, now because this point is parallel, the red circles here and the blue circles are parallel to each other when the selector is at point B. So we have B at here equals to V here, and we can take the current is equal to I shunt to RB plus RC equals to I meter R meter plus RA. Okay, this is the shunt current, this is the meter current. So we have this equation here. We know that the total current I shunt here must be the total current, the current passing in the meter. So I shunt here must be I total minus I meter. So we can replace this part here, I2 minus I meter. Okay. Then we can expand the equation. We get I2 multiply with RB plus RC, and then IM multiply with RB plus RC. So we get this is the first part of the equation, and this is the second part of the equation. Okay, then for the second part here, we can take it to the right hand side, it becomes plus. So we get IM RM plus RA is equal to IM RB plus RC. And so we get the total here, IM plus IM multiply by RM plus RA plus RB plus RC. But we already know previously that R shunt is equal to the whole resistance RA plus RB plus RC. So we can simplify the equation to get, we can take I2 to the right hand side as well, and we are left with RB plus RC. So RB plus RC is equal to this value here. Okay, this is how we calculate RB plus RC. And then the third step, we change the selector to the largest range. In this case, 1 amp. So now the current, it will flow one current, the shunt current will flow from positive into the resistance going here to the negative. So this is the shunt resistance RC. And then the other portion of the current, which is the current through the meter, will flow through here, goes through RA, goes to RB, and then coming back here and flowing back to the negative. So we get the equation I shunt 3, so the current that is flowing only through RC multiplied by RC is equal to IM, current meter, multiplied by RM plus RA plus RB. So we have two different color codes which represent two sides of the equation. So again, we know that the shunt current is the total current minus the current going to the meter. So we have I shunt is equal to I total minus I meter. So we get this equation here. We can expand the equation. We get this part here. And we can take the negative IMRC to the right hand side to get this equation. So again, we get IM, RM plus RA plus RB plus RC. These three resistance is equal to R shunt. And we can take the current I3 to the right hand side to get the value of RC. Okay, so you must understand this R tension. Memang takkan lari. Dalam quiz atau final atau kedua-duanya mesti akan keluar soalan yang berkaitan dengan R tension ni. Okay, so let me go back. So the first step is for you to calculate all the total resistance. This is the first step. And then you calculate the total resistance of RB plus RC. And then you calculate for RC. After you get the value of RC, you replace this value inside this equation here to get RB. And after you get RB, you go back to this equation here and replace RB and RC to get the value of RA. That's the sequence. Okay, let's look at the example. Ada soalan tak? Yang ni dia memang technical sikit lah. Okay, if you do not understand, then the video will be available in the Microsoft Teams for now. So you can go back and try to revise the material to make sure you have a strong understanding. And you can also ask. Okay, so calculate the shunt resistance for the circuit below. Okay, calculate the shunt resistance. Sekarang kita nak cuba calculate. Tapi sekarang dah pukul 12. So, kita ambil short break. So, kita sambung balik 10 minit dari sekarang. 12:13. Okay, after this, I'll continue with the example. So kita break dulu ya.
Doktor.
Ya, silakan. Apa dia?
Test bila?
Test? Test ke quiz?
Quiz. Quiz dengan test lah. Sekarang dah week 4 kan?
Week 4, betul. Test belum decide lagi. Maybe minggu ke 7 atau minggu ke 8.
Okay.
Okay. Nanti detail pasal test saya share bila saya dapat info lah.
Okay, baik.
Alright. Okay, 12:14. So kita sambung balik. So don't forget to record your attendance. It's already been opened in the system. Okay, now let's move back to the question just now. What was the question again? Question was calculate the shunt resistance for the circuit below. Actually the same circuit from just now. We want to calculate what is the shunt resistance. So we have 10.1, 1.01. I think we need to calculate everything, get the answer. So let's do it. So these are the values given. So step one is we need to calculate what is the total shunt resistance. Okay, so let's start with step one. So we want to calculate R-shunt. So R-shunt, we have the equation. The other equation that we can use, Rm and minus 1. Where N equals to the current divided by the current in the meter. So the current is given as 10 milliamps. So 10 milliamps, and the current in the meter is 100 microamps. So 10 milliamp divided by 100 microamp, we get the answer is equal to 100. So we have R in the meter is equal to 1000 ohms. So we have R shunt equals to 1000 ohms divide by 100 minus 1. So 1000 divided by 99, I get 10.1 ohms. Okay, so this is the total resistance. This is RA plus RB plus RC. Okay, settle step one. Okay, now we move to step two. Step two is the 100 milliamp range. So step two, 100 milliamp range. So what was the equation just now? The equation for R shunt 2, which is RB plus RC, is equal to I meter multiply with R meter plus R shunt divide by I 2. So I2 is basically 100 milliamps, the second range, this value here. So we are going to get 100 microamps multiply with the R meter is 1000 ohms plus R shunt 10.1 ohms divide by 100 milliamp. So if you divide, what answer will you get? You should get 100 micro multiply by 1010.1 divide by 100 milli, 1.01 ohms. Okay, so the answer is 1.01 ohms. So this is step 2. So now we move to step 3. So step 3, we move this a bit here. So for step 3, the final range, this is 1M range. Hold on. So we want to calculate RC. So RC is given as IM, still the same RM plus R shunt, but this time divide by I3. So we are going to get 100 microamps. This one is still the same, 1000 ohms plus 10.1 ohms divide by I3. I3 is 1M. Okay, so please be careful of the unit. The unit here is micro. The unit here is ohms. This one here is not, there's no prefix. So your answer, you should get for RC is equivalent to 0.101. Okay, so now we have already got RC. So RC is equivalent to 0.101. So now we can replace. So from step 2, RB plus RC equals to 1.01. So RB equals to 1.01 minus RC. So 1.01 minus 0.101. So we get 0.909 ohms. So this is the value for RB. And then we replace from step 1. Where shall I put it? Okay, maybe I shift it more to the right. So from step 1, so RA plus RB plus RC equals to 10.1 ohms. So RA is equal to 10.1 minus RB plus RC. Or maybe I should put it as minus minus. It's the same thing. So RA equals to 10 minus RB minus RC. So we are going to get, but we have the total here is RB plus RC. Okay, so maybe the best is we simply use this one. Here we put plus here. Okay, so 10 minus RB plus RC, so 10.1 minus 1.01, we get the total answer is, what should the answer be? 9.09, is it? Yeah, 9.09. 9.09 ohms. So this is the answer for RA. So this is how you solve. So you get the answer RA equals to 9.09 ohms. RB is equal to 0.909 ohms, and RC is equal to 0.101 ohms. Okay, this is your answer. Okay, ada soalan tak? Clear tak step dia? Okay, give you a couple of minutes. Kalau perlu, you boleh snap gambar ke? Okay, thank you. Okay, kalau saya tanya soalan ya, apa advantage kalau kita guna meter macam ni, Ayrton Shunt ni? Can you think of any advantages? Apa advantage berbanding dengan meter tadi? What will be the advantage compared to the other type of meter? Okay, you can either answer kat chat pun boleh, jawab dalam hati pun boleh. Try to think of the advantage of this type of meter. Okay, so saya beritahu jawapan dia sekarang. One of the advantage of this meter, kalau kita tengok balik dia punya figure tadi. You see here that even at any point, the selector either in the middle, if you want to change from position A to position B or position B to position C, there will always be the resistance parallel to the meter. Okay, so there will always be, katakan kita nak switch ni, boleh tahu mana yang high precision value. Okay, kejap lagi Fauzan eh. So advantage dia dekat sini, we don't need to have the switch here, the make before break type. So make before break type ni dia mahal sikit daripada switch biasa. Sebab ada mekanism dalam dia yang complicated sedikit lah. But under this condition, we can use ordinary switch because in between the position, bila you switch daripada position A ke position B misalnya, dia tak akan berlaku open circuit di mana current akan flow 100% melalui meter. So the meter will be protected under this condition. Okay, that's maybe one of the reason why it is also called universal shunt. Okay, so Fauzan tanya, boleh tahu mana yang high precision value? Okay, nak jawab soalan tu, mari kita buka internet. Maybe kita boleh type standard resistor values. Okay, let's see what we get. Alright, let's open this example here. Okay, these are an example of standard resistor values. Okay, ini biasanya industri dia standard resistor value ni maknanya kalau you ada company yang keluarkan resistor, semua company yang keluarkan resistor dia punya standard resistor value dia akan sama. Okay, so these are the ranges sample eh. So you ada 1 ohm, 1.1 up to 1.2, 1.3, 1.4 tak ada. You have 1.5. Let me enlarge this a bit. Okay, so maknanya katakan you nak beli satu resistor 1.1 ohms. Dia ada dekat market. You boleh beli direct. Tapi katakan you nak sekarang ni 1.01 ohms. That one we consider as high precision value. You kena customize order. Kalau value tu ada dalam table ni, that means value tu, resistor tu memang dikeluarkan secara bulk, secara besar-besaran. Memang dia produce benda tu secara pada scale, industrial scale. So you tak perlu customize order. So this is already considered as standard resistor values. So kalau bila value tu tak ada dalam table ni, itu kita kata high precision value lah. Okay, lepas tu you tengok dekat sini, dia dah ada caveat, dia dah bagi tahu resistor di sini dia punya tolerance dia plus minus 5%. So, katakan you ambil resistor paling rendah 1 ohm. Dia tetap ada tolerance 5%, maknanya value dia akan lari antara 0.95 hingga 1.05 ohm. Value dia akan akan berada dalam range tu, dia takkan betul-betul fix pada 1.0. Okay, sekarang kita tengok balik soalan tadi. Soalan tadi, dia bagi jawapan dia. Kita terus refer jawapan eh. Sekejap, dia hang. Jadi sekarang ni nak jawab soalan yang mana high precision value, you tengok antara empat-empat ni mana yang you tak boleh dapat daripada table tadi. Jadi kita boleh kata sebenarnya semua ni adalah high precision value yang kita perlu dapat. Maybe 10.1 ni sebab dia combination tiga-tiga ni. So dia bukan separate resistance. So RA, RB, RC ni they are all high precision value. You nak dia punya resistance kena tepat macam ni. Baru you dapat baca meter tu dengan tepat. So nak jawab soalan dia, jawapan dia adalah all RA, RB and RC are resistors with high precision value and we increase the cost of the meter. Right? Okay, requirement of a shunt. Ini teori sikit. So this one is just the concept of the shunt itself. When we solder the circuit, the soldering itself should not cause a voltage drop. Sebab bila kita solder tu, kadang-kadang dia punya contact point dia tu, bila dia tak begitu bagus, dia boleh menyebabkan ada voltage drop. So kita nak dia punya efek dia terhadap haba. Itu dia panggil thermodielectric. Maksudnya bila berlaku haba dan ada haba dan sebagainya, kita nak dia memberi kesan yang minimum terhadap voltage drop. That's point number one. Point number two is solderability. Solderability, kebolehan kita solder lah pada connection point kita tu. So resistance of different sizes and values must be soldered with minimum value in change. Okay. And then we need to observe the following items or the following precautions. We need to make sure that the polarity is correct, positive and negative. We need to always start with the highest current range. And then we should not connect the emitter across a source of EMF directly without the resistance, without the shunt resistance. Okay, so we always connect a meter in series with a load. Okay. And then extending emitter ranges, if you want to extend emitter range, we can simply do that by adding a resistance parallel to the meter. So kita ada meter sekarang, set to the lowest current range. Whenever we have a resistor connected in parallel, so we allow current to flow in the shunt resistor, so we can adjust the circuit to measure higher amount of current compared to the current that can be carried by the meter. Ini adalah konsep asas bagi emitter tadi. Alright, moving on. Next, kita nak masuk tentang DC voltmeter pula. Okay, tadi kita gunakan the Arsonval principle to measure current. Now we want to use the same meter to measure voltage, DC voltage. So this is the first equation you need to know, which is the sensitivity. Sensitivity is denoted by the letter capital S, and it is the ratio of 1 divided by the current of the full scale deflection, IFSD. So FSD is called the full scale deflection current. Okay, this is an important point before you decide whether the meter can be used to measure the voltage or not. Okay, and we call it as sensitivity. So a meter with a full scale current of 50 microamps has a sensitivity of 20 kilo ohms per volt. And a meter with a full scale current of 1 milliamp has a sensitivity of 1 kilo ohm per volt. So the question we need to answer later on is, between these two types of meters, which one is better? The higher value of sensitivity or the lower value of sensitivity? Now we are going to see the effect of the sensitivity when we study about loading effect. So before we cover loading effect, we need to know how to design a DC voltmeter first. So let's look at the basic design. So for a DC voltmeter, the difference is the position of the shunt resistor. Now we do not call it as shunt resistor anymore. So previously when we studied on ammeter, we have the resistor here in parallel with the meter. Now for a voltmeter, we have the resistance in series with the meter. So we want to measure the voltage using the meter here. So we put a resistance in series. What is the function of a resistor? To limit the amount of current. So we want to limit the amount of current to make sure that the current flowing in the circuit does not exceed the current of the meter, the maximum current that can be carried by the meter, IM. So we need to design the value of this resistance. Okay, so previous, don't confuse this one. We use RS. RS here does not mean shunt. S here means series. So series resistance. And it's also called as multiplier resistance. Okay, so we add this resistance here to limit the current that is flowing in the circuit. So again, we have the abbreviation here. IM is the full scale deflection current of the meter. RM is the resistance of the meter itself. RS is the multiplier resistance or the series resistance. And V is the full range voltage of the instrument. Okay, the range of the voltage we want to measure. So when we want to measure voltage in electric, we always measure between two points. We cannot measure voltage only at one point. So kalau you pegang probe multimeter tu, mesti satu dekat positif, satu dekat negatif, baru you akan dapat voltage value. So biasanya negatif ni kita akan sambung pada ground. Dalam litar yang biasalah. Okay, a basic DC Arsonval movement can be converted into a DC voltmeter by adding a series resistor known as the multiplier shown in the figure. And the function is to limit the current, as what I have told you just now. Okay, so let's derive. Again, we derive using basic circuit analysis. Now the voltage here must be equal to the voltage drop here plus the voltage drop here. So the voltage here must be equal to voltage across the resistor plus the voltage across the meter. So the voltage across the resistor is equal to the current multiplied by the resistor. So IM multiplied by RS. And the current flowing in the the voltage here is equal to current across the meter plus current resistance of the meter. So since this is a series circuit, the current that is flowing in both these elements must be the same current. So we have this equation here, V equals to Im Rs plus Rm. So we can modify the equation to get the value of the multiplier resistance equivalent to V divided by Im minus Rm. Okay, and this is the equation that we use to determine, one of the equation that we can use to determine the multiplier resistance. Again, this is only we can use to measure one range. What about if you want to measure more than one range? Then we need to look into the multi-range. But let's look at the example first. So a basic DR Zomba movement, full-scale deflection 50 microamps, internal resistance of 500 ohm is used as a DC voltmeter. So determine the value of the multiplier resistance needed to measure a voltage range of 0 to 10 volts. So the meter current is 50 microamps and the internal resistance of the meter is 500 ohms. So we replace the value to get the value of the multiplier resistance, 199.5 kilo ohms. Okay, notice the difference. Tadi masa kita study ammeter, kita dapat value parallel resistance dia very small. Sekarang bila kita nak design voltmeter, it's going to be the opposite. The multiplier resistance will be very large because we want to limit the amount of current passing through the meter. Okay. So we can also calculate the multiplier resistance using this equation, which is the sensitivity multiplied by the range, and then the total we minus the meter resistance. So if I use the previous example, it's still the same. First, I calculate the sensitivity. So sensitivity is 1 divided by the current of the full scale deflection, okay, which is 50 microamps. So when we divide, we get the unit of 20, and the unit converts into kilo ohm per volt. And then we have S multiplied by the range, 20 kilo ohm per volt multiplied by 10 volt. So volt and volt cancel, we get 20 kilo ohms minus 20 minus multiplied by 10, you get 200 kilo ohms. And then 200 kilo ohm minus 500, we get 199.5 kilo ohms. So the same answer using two different equations. So you need to know both. Both, depending on the question, then you can choose which equation is the most suitable to be used. Okay. So let's look at the next example. Calculate the value of a multiplier resistance on the 50 volt range of a DC voltmeter that uses a 500 microamp meter movement and internal resistance of 1 kilo ohm. So this is basically the same step. So sensitivity is 1 divided by the current of the meter, so we get 2 kilo ohms per volt. And then the value of the multiplier resistance, we use the equation just now to get the answer as 99 kilo ohms. So this is just the same step, but now, like I said, we need to have multiple ranges to make our voltmeter more usable. So similar to a multi-range DC ammeter, we can convert into a multi-range DC voltmeter by having a number of different resistances in parallel. Not in parallel, I can say not in parallel, but in series to the circuit. So we see the example here. So if the switch is connected to point 1, then current will flow into R1 before it flows into the meter. If the switch is moved to position 2, then current will flow to R2 before it flows to the meter, and so on. So this is an example for a 3 voltage range type of meter. Okay, again, for this condition, we do not need to use the make before break type, because when we want to switch from point 1 to point 2, The circuit will be open, so no current will flow in the meter, so the meter will be protected. Okay, so let's look at example of how to design R1, R2 and R3. So we want to measure using the circuit, we want to measure the range 0 to 5, 0 to 50 and 0 to 100 volts. So we can do this by calculating separately. We start with the lowest voltage first. Okay, so for the lowest voltage, I set it as R3. So R3 is equal to this value here, 5 volts divided by 10 milli minus 100. So I get 400 ohms. For 50 volts, it's going to be this value here. You get 4.9 kilo ohms. And for 100 volts, you get 9.9 kilo ohms. So you set R3 is equal to 400 volts. R2 is equal to 4.9 kilo ohms and R1 is equal to 9.9 kilo ohms. All right. Again, we can also rearrange the DC voltmeter so that the value of the resistance is in series with each other. This is what we call as a more practical arrangement. Okay, practical arrangement, because only the smallest resistance or the lowest resistance has to be of special high precision value. The rest can be obtained from standard resistance value. R1, R2, R3 can be taken from standard resistance value depending on the value that we get lah from our calculation. Okay, kalau tadi you tengok ni nilai ni 400 ohms, 4.9 kilo ohms, 9.9 kilo ohms. Okay, ada tak dalam table tadi value-value ni? 400, 4.9, 9.9. So 400 tak ada. Dia ada 390, 430. Lepas tu 4.9, 4.9 pun tak ada. Dia ada 4.7K. Eh? Kejap eh. Tak nampak. Okay. So tadi mula-mula kita kira 400 ohms. Ni daripada table tadi. So 400 ohms kita tengok dekat sini. This one here 390. Tak bergerak ah kat skrin saya. Okay, so tak apa, you cuba tengok table yang saya bagi tadi. Ah okey, baru keluar. So 390 lepas tu 430. So tak ada 400 ohms. And then 4.9. So kita tengok dekat sini ada 4.7, lepas tu terus 5.1, tak ada 4.9, lepas tu 9.9. So kita tengok ada 9.1 kilo ohm, lepas tu terus 10 kilo ohms. So all require you to have customized resistance. Okay, so going back. So we want to verify that for this configuration, when we have the resistors in series, only the lowest resistance will have a special manufactured value. The rest we can obtain from standard resistor value available in the market. Okay, this is how we derive. So to calculate the multiplier resistance, we can derive using the following equation. So R4. Ini tadilah daripada shunt value tadi. R4 is equal to V4 divided by IM minus RM. So R3 is equal to V3 divided by IM minus the combination of RM plus R4. So for R2 kita tambah sini R3 R4, sini tukar V2. And for R1, we have V1 and then we have R2 plus R3 plus R4. Okay, so macam mana dia derive benda ni, dia gantung balik pada circuit ni tadi. So bila you start always with the lowest range. Okay, saya ada 10 minit lagi, so mungkin saya akan stop dalam 1-2 slide lagi. Bila dia connect pada position 4, so sekarang ni dia punya shunt resistance dia adalah only R4 sahaja. So we need to calculate R4 plus RM. No, I mean R4 is equal to R4 divided by RM lah. The voltage divided by the total current minus the meter here. Bila kita tukar pada position V3, sekarang bila arus mengalir, current flow, it will flow through R3 and R4 and RM. So that's why at position 3, we have V3 and then RM plus R4. Okay, and then for V2, the voltage here is equivalent to R3 plus R4. We need to calculate R2 here after we calculate R3 and R4 and IM. And finally, when we put to position V1, then we want to know R1, we need to add R2 plus R3 plus R4 plus RM. Sebab dia semua in series. So that's why we have this step here. We start with the lowest range, then we increase until the highest range. So on the right hand side, it's basically the same equation. We can use V divided by I, we change into sensitivity multiplied by the voltage range. So we start with the lowest up to the highest. So the second part is the same, either left side or right side. Okay. So let's repeat the previous derivation using calculate the multiplier resistance if they are connected in series as shown in the figure here, and then compare your results with the previous answer. Okay, tadi kita dah buat soalan and then kita dapat value dia yang ni tadi 400, 4.9, 9.9. So sekarang kita nak measure range yang sama 0 to 5, 0 to 50 and 0 to 100. Tetapi sekarang ni kita punya resistance all in series. Okay, so how are we going to calculate? We need to utilize the equation that is given in the previous slide, which is this one. Okay, but this one is for 4 resistance, so we need to change now into 3 resistance. Okay. So I'm going to finish with this example. So let me copy first. And then let me copy the equation here. Okay, and the range is given as, let's check the range. 0 to 5 volts, 0 to 50 volts, and 0 to 100 volts. Okay, range 0 to 5 volts, 0 to 50 volts, 0 to 50 volts, and 0 to 100 volts. Okay, so it only has 3 resistance, so we are going to replace R4 with R3. So we are modifying this equation a bit. So for R3, is going to be V3 divided by IM minus RM. So what was the IM and RM just now? So IM is 10 milliamps, RM is 100 ohms. So 10 milliamps, RM is 100 ohms. So we can use the equation equals to 5 volt divide by 10 milliamps minus 100 ohms. So you are going to get 5 divided by 10 milli. Oh, yeah, you're right. You can't see anything. Yeah, yeah, betul, betul. Kejap eh. I don't know why. Let me off and on again. Okay, thank you. Saya tak perasan pun. Okay, so saya start balik. So we have the circuit here. We want to have the range from 0 to 5, 0 to 50 and 0 to 100 volts. So this is the equation just now. So I'm going to modify the equation here a bit because we only have 3 resistors. So this is going to become R3. This is going to become R2 and this is going to become R1. So R3 is equal to V3 divided by IM minus RM. So we replace the value, we get the answer is 400 ohms. Dah boleh nampak kan?
Boleh.
Okay. Kemudian kita calculate pula untuk R2. So R2 is equal to V2 divided by IM minus RM plus R3. So we have the voltage that V2 equals to 50 volt divided by the same 10 milliamps. Now minus the R meter is 100 plus R3, so 500 ohms. 100 ohm plus 400 ohms. So what is the answer? Let me check. 50 divided by 10 milli. And then minus 500. So we get 4.5 kilo ohms. And then for R1. Ya, Kushairi, ada soalan ke?
Thank you.
You on mic tu? Oh. R1 is equal to V1 divided by IM minus RM plus R2 plus R3. So, sorry, this one should be kilo ohm. Okay. And then so for V1 the range is 100 volt divided by 10 milliamps minus, so RM is 100 plus R2 is 4.5 and R3 is 400. So this one is what? 5 kilo ohm, 4.5 plus 0.5, so this one is equivalent to 5 kilo ohms. So we are going to get 100 divided by 10 milli, so 10,000. So equivalent to 10 kilo ohms, and then minus, is it 10 kilo ohms? Minus 5 kilo ohms, So it's going to get 5 kilo ohms. Did I get it correct? So what was the answer just now? Okay. So we get 400, 4.5 and 5 kilo ohms. This was the answer and we already proved it from the solution here. Okay, so 4.5 and 5. Let us double check with the standard resistor. Okay, so here for the standard resistor, 4.5 we don't have. 5.1 we also don't have. So I'm not sure why. By right, 4.5 and 5 kilo ohms are standard resistor values that we can obtain from the market. So maybe this table I need to double check whether it's correct or not, because I'm just taking from the first resource. But anyway, the point I want to highlight is okay, it's 1 o'clock already, so I'm going to finish with this slide. So this one, we get rounded values, 400 ohms, 4.5 kilo ohms and 5 kilo ohms. So it's a nice rounded values compared to the previous one just now, we get 4.9 kilo ohms and 9.9 kilo ohms. So this one is what we say that the value for R1 and R2 are standard value resistors. So you need to find only specific resistors for the lowest value of the voltmeter range. Okay, so in our next class next week, we are going to go into a multi-range DC voltmeter where we have resistance in series, and then we are going also into look into the loading effect for voltmeter and ammeter. Okay, that's it for today. So thank you for. I apologize for the short delay and the problem with the slide just now. So are there any questions?
Doctor, you learn belum dapat lagi attendance.
Belum dapat. Okay, hold on. Saya double check. Saya kena tengok student view lah kalau macam tu. Okay, sekejap ya. Nak register attendant. Nanti sekejap. Saya download dulu dekat ni. Okay, saya dah download attendance list. Okay, sekejap. Okay, so dah boleh dah. Dah ada orang save record dah. Sekejap saya buka balik. Okay, Navi, tunggu sekejap ya. Cannot share the screen. Tapi tak apalah, attendance saya dah ada orang boleh share register dah, so you just make sure that your name is there so that you can record. So Navin dengan Amir ni, attendance you tak ada, nama you tak ada dalam list ke ataupun macam mana? Ada kan?
Ada doktor, boleh take attendance tu minggu ni tapi minggu lepas 2 hari pun tak boleh take. Memang tak ada.
Okay, saya note dululah. Sekarang saya tak ni, nanti saya note dulu. Navin dengan Amir Azlan, okay.
Lagi satu orang, Dr. Jaken.
Siapa?
Jaken.
Jaken, okay. Dia dah ada mesej dah.
Okay, Doktor.
Okay.
Thank you, Doktor. Lepas tu,
Taufik kata 11 sampai 3. Tak, saya saja panjangkan. Sebab takut kalau saya set sampai pukul 1, orang tak sempat nak login tadi. So, kelas kita 11 sampai 1 saja. Saya sengaja extend sampai pukul 3 supaya you still boleh save record sekarang. Sekejap lagi saya tutup lah.
Dapat surah doktor, by the way, thank you.
Okay. Okay, so Faris, Jaken, okay tak apa, nanti saya tengok balik dekat meeting chat ni, nanti saya edit balik lah attendance tu, saya boleh override. Okay, thank you for your time. Dah satu lebih dah. Take a good rest. See you tomorrow for your quiz.
Stay safe, Dr.
Thank you, Dr. Assalamualaikum.
Okay, see you. Take care.